frequency, because it's the low frequency that there are from which issues related to how to perform research and clinical trials, how to organize the healthcare system, how to handle in the clinical practice rare cancers, are really the typical difficulties faced when we have to deal with a low frequency type of disease like the rare cancers. And that's why it's only the frequency that defines basically rare cancers. And we selected incidence instead of prevalence because incidence is less impacted from the prognosis of the cancers. Let's take the example. I always do this example of lung cancers. Lung cancers is one of the most common cancers in terms of incidence, in terms of number of new cancer cases diagnosed every year. However, the prognosis is very low, so the prevalence is low. Whereas when we have a cancer, like for example testicular cancers that are very low maybe in terms of incidence but have a very good prognosis, this would imply high prevalence. And that's the reason why, considering that cancer and rare cancers are more type of subacute disease and not yet chronic disease, because we still have to make most of cancers and rare cancers chronic disease, incidence was felt as a better indicator than prevalence for defining rare cancers. But the definition was not enough, because when we had to provide a list of rare cancers, we really felt that the standard statistics that are usually provided epidemiological speaking were using a classification that was mainly based on the topography. I think everybody is used to hear about, you know, which is the incidence or how it's changing the incidence, the prevalence or the survival of lung cancers, of prostate cancers, of thyroid cancers. But we are much less used from the epidemiological perspective to deal with definition of tumors that are more based on the histology. And for most of rare cancers, our more specific histology, logical-based definition was really needed, very similar to the experience of the childhood cancers, which has a slightly different classification because of the need to better identify the specificity, also going into the details of the histological definition. So in the context of a project, an epidemiological project, Rare Care, we basically started from the WHO Blue Book. The WHO Blue Book are basically translated from the epidemiological point of view into the International Classification of Disease of Oncology, which is really the standard classification that is used for providing routine statistics. So we started basically from what also you clinical expert know very well, so from the pathological entities of the WHO, which basically represent what we call the tier 3 of this huge list. We moved from pathological entities into clinically relevant entities, and were these clinically relevant entities to basically identify rare cancers. And through this exercise, we managed to identify almost 200 different type of rare cancers. The details can be found at the website that is reported in these slides. But very rapidly, if you're wondering, so in the end, which are the rare cancers, we managed to group them into 12 major families of rare cancers. One is represented by the childhood cancers, because all childhood cancers are rare cancers. All hematological cancers are, currently speaking, rare cancers, especially if we have in mind the latest WHO classification of the hematological neoplasm. And then we have what we usually refer to 10 major families of rare adult solid cancers that are sarcomas, all sarcomas, soft tissue, bone sarcomas. In the soft tissue, of course, we include also the visceral sarcoma, the rare thoracic cancer, just to give you a few examples, thymic cancers or trachea, mesothelioma, neuroendocrine tumors, head and neck cancers, all the different sites of head and neck are rare cancers, even the laryngeal one, which I know in according to the different countries in Europe, the incidence might not be felt as rare, but the definition of rare cancers is based on the European population. So you should never, in a certain sense, try to identify the rare cancers using the specific country incidence rate, because the definition of rare cancers, as well as the one for rare disease, is based on a European population level. Because as we will see, these are clear cancers for which we really need collaboration, and there is an added value in European and international collaborative effort. Central nervous system tumors, rare female genital cancers such as vulva, vagina, rare urological such as the testicular, penile, endocrine gland. Also here of interest is to mention thyroid cancers, which again, as the example I made about larynx, might sound strange. We know that there might be exception because, of course, of different intensive type of aggressive diagnostic, or of course because of a very specific exposure. But at European level, also thyroid cancer, for example, are rare, digestive rare cancers, and here we may refer to tumors of anus or small intestine, rare skin, and non-cutaneous melanoma. So you see that there are 12 big families, but within each of these families, there are very different and heterogeneous type of tumors. And the way we basically manage to really provide data on this different plethora of tumors is using population-based cancer registry. I don't know how many of you are aware about the population-based cancer registry. These are institutions that basically collect all new cases of cancers coming from population that is resident in a specific geographical area. Just to give you an example, this is a map of the Eurocare 5 study that we basically used for the RareCareNet project. You can see that in the Nordic country, like Norway, Sweden, Finland, the population-based cancer registry have a national coverage. It means that they cover all the residents within the nation, while in other countries such as Italy, the cancer registry do not cover the entire country, but only some specific area. So population-based cancer registry register all cases of new cancer within a specific geographical area, and they collect data for the population that lives resident in this specific area. What is important is that at European level, there are international associations that try to combine and provide recommendation for standardizing the data coming from the different cancer registries, and there are also international efforts led by the International Agency for Research on Cancers, but also from Concord, that are really trying to put together the data from the different cancer registry to properly monitor the cancer epidemiology at European and global level. This is rare because it's thanks to one of these collaborative projects, Eurocare, that we basically manage to launch the epidemiological project that led us to have a list and a definition of rare cancers. Because as I was saying since the beginning, these are basically rare. And therefore, we really need big databases to be able to provide robust indicators for these tumors. And that's why I would always pay attention to data coming from a very small population-based cancer registry, because the uncertainty around the estimates might be much higher and should therefore be interpreted with caution. We don't have a Russian cancer registry because in Eurocare, this is a collaborative effort, and we didn't manage to include the Russian Cancer Registry in Eurocare 5, and also in the new round we are analyzing Eurocare 6. Unfortunately, Russian Cancer Registry are not included, although I know that some of them have contributed to cancer incidence in 5 continents, so I hope that maybe through this opportunity we might increase our collaboration and knowledge. The two projects that basically set numbers for rare cancers in Europe are RareCare and RareCareNet, and this has been also already showed, the latest data showing basically the impact of rare cancers at European level. But what I think it's important to observe is that if at European level cancer registry represents almost 20% of new cancer cases, this is the same, the burden of rare cancers is very similar across the different countries in Europe. As you can see, for each of the countries that are ranked based on the decreasing population, the burden of rare cancers is around 20%. And this is not only the case in Europe and across European country. It is the same also when we go to the other side of the ocean in the United States. This is a paper that used exactly the same definition and list of rare cancers, showing that also in the United States, rare cancers represent 20% of new cancer diagnosis. This is another collaborative effort done with the Registry of São Paulo in Brazil. Again, 20% of cancers diagnosed every year are rare cancers. And thanks also to some to ESMO Asia, an initiative from ESMO, we basically managed to extend the collaboration also in Asia. We are currently working with 3 population-based cancer registry, Taiwan, Korea, and Japan. Here you can see that again the burden is slightly different, but still, you know, in the framework of 20%. And this paper and this collaborative work for us was very important, not only to estimate the impact of rare cancers, but to show that the list of rare cancers that was identified at European level was fitted well also other type of context, such as South America and East Asia, where we know there are different risk factors, and especially for some type of cancer and rare cancers, there are different epidemiological features. Regardless of these differences, this collaborative work supported the idea that the list of rare cancers that we define in Europe fit well also other contexts, which is relevant thinking to national, international collaborative project. But when we deal about rare cancers, it's true that altogether, all the almost 200 type of rare cancers, you know, have an important impact, especially from the public health perspective. Unfortunately, when we have to do research on rare cancers, or when you have to deal with a rare cancer patient in the clinical practice, the reality is completely different from the one I just showed to you, because you teach me agree that most of rare cancers are really rare, have an incidence, you see, out of the almost 200 type of different rare cancers, 140 have an incidence lower than 0.5. So we are really talking about very rare cancers that for some oncologists might be really hard seeing also in their entire life. And in fact, in the figures B, you can see that all the 140 different type of very rare cancers leads to less than 100,000 new diagnoses, whereas the number of cases diagnosed with cancers increased a lot if we look at few cancers that have an incidence higher than 6. So here we mainly have colon, prostate, breast, and lung cancer. So you see that for the four most common type of cancers are responsible of almost, you know, 10 times the numbers of cases that derives from very heterogeneous high numbers of rare tumors. So it's really a challenge to deal, especially from the clinical point of view, with this type of rare entities and such heterogeneous type of tumors. In addition, it's worth mentioning that unfortunately, when we go and try to understand which is the prognosis, which is the survival of rare cancers, most of rare cancers have a survival less than 50%. Epidemiologically speaking, we refer to relative survival, which is an indicator that has to be interpreted as the cancer-specific survival, so at the net of other causes of death. So it's really an indicator of the cancer-specific mortality. And unfortunately, not all, but most, many rare cancers have survival lower than 50% after 5 years. It means that from a cohort diagnosed with a rare cancers, after 5 years, less than 50% of these patients are still alive. The quality of care for rare cancers is suboptimal. This is just an example of a study that was performed in Europe across different European countries for head and neck. And here we really show that there are issues with regards to the timeliness of starting treatment, but also in the quality and in the adherence, basically, of the guidelines recommended for this type of rare cancers, and especially when we are dealing with advanced type of head and neck cancers. I don't want to go into the detail, but just to send a message that there are issues with regards to the quality of care for these rare cancers. And in the end, when we go and to compare the survival, the five-year relative survival across the different countries in Europe, you see that the different the red one is the European average, and you see how the survival of all rare cancers differs across European countries, clearly indicating that there are issues of inequalities of care in terms of both diagnosis and treatment for this type of tumors. So what has been proposed? How Europe has decided to try to address these challenges at European level, because the rarity makes rare cancers a good example of a European added value in sense of a supranational collaboration. Almost 3 years or 4 years ago, the European Reference Network, which are virtual network of healthcare providers providing basically second multidisciplinary diagnosis and expertise also for the treatment, were established Actually, 24 European reference network have been launched at European level. Three of these European reference networks are related to rare cancers. If you recall the families of rare cancers I presented to you earlier on, you can see that these three European reference network are tailored to that family. In fact, PETCAN is the ERN on childhood cancers, the first family I showed you in my previous slide. EuroBloodNet is the ERN dedicated to the hematological cancers, the second family I showed you earlier on. And the third one, EuroCan, is the ERN dedicated to the rare adult solid cancers, which basically include the 10 families of cancers that again were summarized in my slides. So you can see how the epidemiological effort of identifying and the collaborative effort also of the JARC to properly define also the family of rare cancers was used from the public health perspective and also from the European perspective to really push for a solution and for, in a certain sense, driven the identification of the ERN for rare cancers. As I was trying to explain earlier on, how the ERN works, it works that if a patient accesses a national healthcare provider that might not have the necessary expertise for treating a rare cancer, the medical doctors of the patient, with the consent of the patient, can ask advice to the specific ERN, and that's why I was saying that these are virtual network, because the expertise, the experts are basically in their own institute, but through the connection in a tool that was developed by the European Commission, the Clinical Patient Management System, they are able basically to share the information from a specific patient and to discuss the patient, providing second multidisciplinary advice to a center that might not be expert for a specific disease. But the European Reference Network have also additional tasks like development of clinical guidelines, promotion of research and innovation, generating of course new information for researchers and for patients, and also training. So it's really not something new that we are actually experiences. We are really trying to make the ERN a success, but there are several challenges. Happy to come back on this in the discussion, but this is what at European level we are really trying to address the rare cancers. The problem is that the European reference network are basically European networks, and so far they are made of almost 80 different healthcare providers, and it's almost impossible that such a low number of expert healthcare providers can deal with more than 600 new cancer rare cancer patients diagnosed every year. And that's why, since the Joint Action on Rare Cancers started, we are basically promoting the message that national networks, national effort should be established to fully integrate the European network within the national healthcare service. And as I was saying, and I'm going to conclude, in the context of the Joint Action on Rare Cancers, I'm sure Professor Casale will come back on this also later on, two major recommendations were included among the 10, and these are really related to the importance for healthcare system to exploit the networking, not only for the clinical management, but also for supporting research on rare cancers. And last but not least, since 2 months, a new project has started in the context of the ERN EuroCan to try to develop a clinical registry on rare adult solid cancers, hoping that it will be a resource for improving the knowledge of rare adult solid cancer. And I thank you for your attention.